and it's never failing. All things are well for my good. He's intentional. What's up, what's up, what's up, good peoples? Welcome to Hamilton Radio on the net. Welcome to Hamilton Radio on the app, Channel 2. This is your show, Urban Economics and Development Podcast, with your host, Andre Williams, Sr. Man, I am delighted to be back in the building. It's been a few weeks since I've actually been on the air. Had a lot of things occur in the family, and had to do some traveling and a lot of other things that came up as well. You just have to take time off for yourself to restore and regroup, especially after losing loved ones. You kind of have to reprioritize things, which brings us to my topic tonight. Prioritizing over procrastination. Prioritize over procrastination. I teach on this topic several times a week when I'm dealing with my employees and some of the classes that I teach. And a lot of times people say, "Hey, man, you know, I'm procrastinating on a certain project, or I'm procrastinating on a certain thing that I need to get done, whether it's going back to school or whether it's making a decision on some business ideas, or just getting something done at their home." You know, a lot of people, you know, say, I gotta stop procrastinating. This is how they perceive it. And then I kind of give them another way to look at what it is that they're doing and some of the things that I see them actually complete. And the difference is, when you prioritize what it is that you're trying to get done or what it is that you're trying to achieve, you always get it done because it's at the top of your priority list. So there are certain things that you'll do every single day without no issues, without no problems, because it's high up on your priority list. And then there's other things that are kind of lower on your priority list. And, you know, some people, you know, when they're taking tests, so to speak, right? So if they're taking a test and they know the test is coming up in 2 weeks, so what they'll do is they'll find other things to do opposed to studying a little bit each day. Leading up to the actual test, they'll cram. I used to do the same thing when I was in school. I would cram the night before the test, and I would just kind of just stay up all night and read and study and try to remember as much as I could, and try to have little cheat sheets in my mental Rolodex, and I would be able to pull out those little tiny things that I would remember to help me do well on a test. And some people have a good enough memory to where you can do that if you practice it. But for the most part, it's not a good practice to cram. It's best to kind of digest the information, process it, and then you're prepared for the test, and you're going in fresh. You're not staying up all night trying to, you know, cram in all this information. So in those situations, when I talk to students, I explain to them that, you know, it's not that you were procrastinating. It's just that this wasn't high up on your priority list. And we have to change that. And that's what we're going to talk about tonight. How can we prioritize our list of things that are due sooner than later? How can we prioritize that list, and how can we achieve the maximum result out of prioritizing? And just like anything else, it takes practice. So, you know, there are strategies that you can use to put things in the forefront of your mind and still accomplish your goal. I'm actually trying to share this on Facebook, and for some reason, I'm not able to start the watch party. But anyway, we'll continue. One of the things that when I look at prioritizing, when I wanted to develop this new book that I'm writing called Plant the Seed, Grow the Dream, and I started writing this book probably about 6 months ago. Now, it was a total different process than my first book, which we'll touch on some of the strategies I used in here when it came to prioritizing. The first book, Everybody is a Real Estate Investor, Yes, Even You, kind of flowed right out of me. I was able to write this book in a matter of, really in a matter of days. But there were some things that wouldn't sit right in my spirit with me releasing it as soon as I completed it. And there was a reason why, and I didn't understand it at the time, because I'm like, okay, the book is complete. I should be able to put this book out by the new year. And, you know, it like I said, it took me a few days. I had the artwork completed. My editor was done, and she was, like, kind of waiting on me. And it didn't hit me until maybe about a week after all of the artwork and everything was complete that I needed to add something into this book to make it more personal. So when people read it, they'll get a piece of me. So on top of learning the real estate strategies, some people need encouragement, and that's, you know, big on my, that's big as far as my purpose is concerned. I like to encourage people, and that's just something that I do daily. Even with my posts on social media, it's always something encouraging, because you never know what people are really going through. And to me, it's personal when I do that, because I take some, you know, from some of the things that I've learned over the years, and some of the things that I experienced, and some of the quotes that I use or posts that I make, they encourage me. So I said, why don't I incorporate that in between the chapters of my book and tie it in so that people see that the principles that I'm teaching on are really principles that I've learned over the years just by studying God's word. And, you know, I tie some of it back into scriptures that I read or old proverbs that I read, and it worked out perfectly. So some of the reviews that I get on the book from people, they always comment on, of course, the strategies. We teach in the real estate strategies, but they also comment on some of the posts and the quotes that I put in between the chapters. So my editor in her way of thinking could have thought that, hey, Dre is procrastinating. And in my way of teaching and understanding, I knew that it wasn't a procrastination, because this was very high up on my priority list. But it was missing something, and I didn't get what it was missing until pretty much the 11th hour. And, you know, once I added those encouraging quotes in the middle and tied them back to some of the scriptures when it came to real estate investing and how I look at having dominion over the land, how that was a part of God's way of saying that we need to own more, we need to invest more, we need to be over more when it comes to real estate investing. So I was able to tie it right into the book, and it was perfect, because a lot of ministers would look at the book and they would contact me and say, hey man, I want you to come, you know, teach some of these strategies at my church, or teach it to me so that, you know, I can help my people with home ownership and different things like that. So in a situation like that, it wasn't procrastination, but it was high up on the priority list. It was just something else was needed to bring the book to the peak that it was supposed to, you know, meet when people actually read the book. It's supposed to impact them a certain way. And because these quotes were personal to me and I've used them over the years, you know, it really helped me out a lot. And it's continuing to help people. I've actually developed a course that I teach every Wednesday night at 6 p.m. At one of my offices here in New Jersey. And it continues to supersede everything that I thought the book was meant to do. Now, when I wrote the book, I used a lot of the real estate techniques that I've used in flipping properties, wholesaling properties, buying tax liens, buying foreclosures. So, in the strategies that I've used, I wrote about them in the book. I wrote about some of the experience, how, you know, I would buy properties for $5,000-$6,000. I'm going back almost 20 years. I would buy these abandoned properties for $5,000 or $6,000. I would invest, you know, between $20,000 to $30,000 because, you know, I own a construction company as well. So it didn't cost me what it would cost everyone else to rehab a property. So me and my guys would go in and rehab it. So I'm into this property about maybe $30,000-$35,000. But at that time, I was able to turn around and sell the same property for $135,000 or $128,000 or $115,000 and make a great profit off of it. So, of course, that was high on my priority list to teach these strategies in the book. But at the same time, the things that came naturally and easily for me, they came to me that way because that's basically how I was trained as a child. My father owned real estate properties here in Trenton, and he taught me the construction trade, taught me electrical, he taught me plumbing, he taught me roofing, framing, HVAC, and I paid attention to all of those things as he was teaching them to me. And as I developed a deeper craftsman for it, I kind of said, okay, I want to take it to the next level. Like, I saw what Dad did, but I want to take it to the next level, and I want to invest in commercial properties as well. And then it went from investing in residential to commercial and starting businesses. One of the businesses that we were able to start was Noah's Ark Daycare and Noah's Ark Preschool. And two of my buildings that I have needed work, and the timing was perfect because I had already the skill trade level to rehab this commercial property and then put a business in it to turn a profit. So it worked out perfect. And now the school has been in existence for about 16 years. And at one point in time, these were high up on my priority list because I was trying to birth something. And in giving birth to your ideas, you have to give each idea 100% of your attention in its infancy stage. It's almost like having children, right? So when you have a baby or an infant, the mother or the father has to give this child 100% of their attention. And for that first couple days the baby come home, like, you're really sensitive to everything. Every movement that the baby make, you're kind of just like going back and, you know, even if you walk out of the room to go brush your teeth or something, sometimes I've seen, or I've done it, and I would have my baby in the carrier and I'd sit him right by the bathroom, you know, while I'm brushing my teeth so I could see him, you know. So that attention was because you're giving birth, you gave birth to something precious, right? And you're pouring as much love and building a strong connection with this infant. And I kind of took those same thought patterns into developing businesses and rehabbing properties. And when I first started, it was literally like these were like my children. You know what I mean? When I would buy an abandoned house, I made it a priority to say, okay, in the beginning, I had to watch, you know, how my guys were doing the work, and my father, you know, at that time he was right on my hip, or if I wasn't there, my father was there. If he wasn't there, I made sure that I was there, and we were kind of just monitoring everything. We wanted the framing to be just right. We wanted the tiles to lay just right, the electrical and the plumbing and all of the things that we were incorporating into this property. We babied it, and then we got to the point to where, okay, as the project developed, we were able to delegate some of the responsibility to other people on our team. And, you know, before you know it, you had one successful flip or rental, depending on what your goal was. And that's how we prioritized our properties, based on the project's goal. What was our goal for that project? So in prioritizing, I encourage whoever is listening that's getting ready to embark on something great or something that's going to take you to the next level, prioritize by writing it down first. If you take the time to write your goal out and put a time stamp on it, that shows accountability. And sometimes you might not hit the goal mark, but if you have a time frame, what it's going to do is going to make you accountable, and it's going to put you in a position to where you have to work on this property, or work on this project, or work on this goal that you have. And by writing it down, what I try to do is I come up with time frames of when I want to accomplish a portion of whatever the project is or whatever the goal is. So if it's school, you want to go back to school and grab a degree, you prioritize. So, you know, your first week, I try to separate it into time frames. I'll do like maybe a 1-day goal. I'll do a 1-week goal. I'll do a 1-month goal. And I'll do, you know, a 6-month goal, or a 1-year goal. And when you're writing these dates out, you have a certain portion that you need to complete. So if you're going back to school and you know, you want to get another degree, or you want to get your GED, or you want to get through high school and, you know, go to college, you set your goals out and you write your goals out. What do you want to accomplish within this, you know, one day? All right, so tomorrow we know, okay, it's a fresh day. You know, if it's a school that you want to apply to, now I'll start researching the school, learn some more about the school, learn some more about the administration at the school. So I would spend 1 hour, 2 hours researching the information that I'm going to have to apply to make sure I meet that one-day goal. So if it's, you know, filling out the application, or meeting with an architect, or registering for school, you're going to research it that first day so that you know, okay, this is what I need to do in order to get through this first day of making sure this project's, you know, it has a foundation. And writing it helps you set that foundation. So, okay, we meet the one-day goal. So now we have a one-week goal. The one-week goal is to, you know, be registered, get our books paid for. Or if it's a project, you want to kind of pull your team together. If it's a real estate project, you know, I kind of like to meet with, you know, different architects or title companies or other subcontractors that I might want to bring in to complete a certain portion of the job. I'll meet with my team, of course, and then we'll hash out, okay, this is what we need to accomplish, because I'm purchasing this particular property, or I'm going into this endeavor, and I need some of your knowledge, I need some of your information. So you prioritizing your time to, you know, basically be available to meet with these individuals to help set a firm foundation for what it is that you plan on doing. And me and the producer of this particular show, Ruben, we were talking a few minutes ago about birthing new projects. And sometimes when you birth in a new project, you can speak about it a little bit too soon. Not for you, because, you know, we have to speak things into existence. But for other people, when they hear you talk about a project or talk about something that they're going to gravitate to or going to be interested in, they kind of, and it's a good thing, they kind of hold you accountable. So they always want to know, like when is this joint coming? Like, when is it happening? When is it coming out? When will it be completed? And sometimes it's a double-edged sword, because you're speaking about it, but it's only because of the excitement of, oh, I'm about to birth something new and I'm excited about it, so I got to tell somebody. But when you tell individuals that don't understand, there's a process, and that process requires research, and that process requires funding a lot of times. And you have to get a lot of things in order to bring, you know, certain projects to manifestation. So in doing that, you have to be careful, you know, with who you tell, because, you know, some people that you tell will understand the process and just be, you know, rooting for you. But some other people will be like, oh man, we'll start speaking ill against the project or ill against the goal, because they never seen anyone do it before. And without knowing that they're speaking ill of it, oh man, you procrastinating, or oh, this ain't gonna happen, or why is it taking so long? Like, those kind of people, you can't tell about future projects unless you help reprogram their way of thinking and teach them that there's a process to manifestation. And depending on the level of this investment, it requires a certain amount of funding that have to be kicked in. And, you know, depending on if you have business credit already established or financial backers, it may take this project a little longer to get off the ground. So in those cases, it's still a priority to you and you're working on it. It's just some behind the scenes things that have to be done. And, you know, you prioritize it according to, you know, whatever that budget is going to be. And you take your time and you do a little bit at a time. And most people don't understand that process. So in those cases, you know, be careful of who you kind of tear your dreams to, because even though they will be rooting for you in one sense, they can speak ill words over it at the same time. And words have power. You know what I mean? So we got to be careful of who we tell. We don't want anybody planting bad seeds on anything that you're planning to produce that's going to be helpful to a lot of people. And they unknowingly do it. So you really can't blame them. So as visionaries, you know, we tend to be a little bit more careful when we share our vision, because we want it to be with like-minded individuals. And we call it a mastermind alliance. So when we have a mastermind alliance, we can get with certain people on our team, and we can share information with them. And they'll understand it completely, and it'll come to pass, because that's the plan for it. That's what we intended for it to do. Take flight. You know what I mean? So with prioritizing, like I said, it's always best to write it down. And as you're writing it, you'll be able to check certain pieces of it off your list as you complete it. One of the projects that we're working on now, we went from only doing one house at a time to actually being able to complete 5 and 6 properties at a time. And now we're getting into bigger projects to where some of the properties are multifamily properties. And it still takes the same system, but you're breaking it down so that everyone that's a part of this bigger project knows their part, knows their role, and they're bringing that to the table to bring the whole project to a manifestation. And then we still set a timeline. We say, okay, we know how funding is set up. We know how draws are set up. And according to properties that we are flipping, we have a different approach to it, because we're saying, okay, this project, we have funding that's going to last us for about 12 months. Our goal is to get these properties up and running within 6 months, get them up and running and possibly sold within 6 months. So I, even though we stretched the project out or the funding out for 12, we want to cut it in half because, one, we need to make our money back ASAP, you know what I mean? So we'll cut it in half now, but we'll have to, we'll have to hire more people and put more people in places to push the project along. So increasing our team was key, but at the same time, showing them the complete vision so that the persons that we're delegating a responsibility to, we call them project managers. So for different properties, we'll have different project managers. And their goal, our goal, basically is to educate them on what our blueprint calls for and what our timeline calls for. So as we delegate the responsibility to the project manager, the project manager is then delegating responsibility to their crew. And they all have the understanding that, okay, I'm in charge of this project. There's a time frame that we need to complete this project, and this is how we approach it. Now, sometimes things may change. Some of the things that we didn't account for, and so we'll have to, you know, meet with the project manager, and we'll say, okay, let's see what changes that we're going to make to make this even more, I guess, comfortable for the new homeowners. So they'll, you know, make suggestions. We'll look at the suggestions, and then we'll determine together if it works. Like one of the projects we're doing now, the project manager came to me and said, okay, well, we have a small bathroom on the second floor. Is it possible to make this bathroom a little bigger and add a window into the bathroom? And, you know, I came over and, you know, they had some ideas written down, and they showed me where they would put the window and then how we can actually, there was a closet behind the wall where the sink is sitting, and they would make the suggestion, hey, let's take a little bit of this closet because we need to come up this way anyway with the HVAC system. And, you know, they showed me what they thought would be, you know, beneficial to give sufficient room in a bathroom, especially in a property that we were flipping. And we want to get, you know, as much as we can. As far as the market value is concerned, we want to be at the top of the market value. So we always try to go above and beyond with our craftsmanship. And I looked at it, you know, I made a few suggestions, and it made sense. So we were able to add that after, you know, the original blueprint, and it worked. It didn't create any potential problems as far as support walls or anything like that. And it was just a closet with a non-load-bearing wall, and, you know, we were able to widen it up a little bit and make it work. So now changes like that, you stay open to. We're still meeting our deadline. It's not going to take away from our deadline, and it's going to add value to the property and add sufficient space to the new homeowners, and you know, just make it more convenient for them to be able to operate and maneuver. So it made sense, and we make changes like that on the fly. Even after we already have blueprints, we'll, you know, make these suggestions with our architect. The architect will look at it, make sure it meets code, and, you know, we'll go with it, you know what I mean? And some projects will go like that. But as far as making it a priority, what happens is now, like I said in the beginning, we started off with managing properties or fixing up our properties one at a time. And during that time, we had a smaller crew. So being that our crew was smaller, I had to focus, you know, a lot of my attention in the beginning on those one properties at a time. And you know, it worked. Because, you know, I was just learning, so these properties were really like my babies, and I didn't want it to go, wrong. So I gave it all of my attention. And then as we got better and hired more people that were definitely qualified, and we were able to delegate some of that responsibility to them. So now what I try to do is duplicate me into our crew, our foremen. I try to duplicate me. I don't want to hold anybody back. I want everybody that's on my team to progress and become investors just like I am. Like, I don't look at them as just employees. So the priority for me is to educate them. Like, I can't equip you with the knowledge of how to fix up properties and keep you stagnated when I know, okay, you know, you need to own property too. You know what I mean? You need to leave a legacy too. So I can't just let you stay at that same level. I'll open that door to educate them and train them, that, you know, so they're not just thinking as contractors. So maybe by the, you know, fourth or fifth property that you're doing with me, you saved up enough money to actually invest in a property as well. And that's our goal. And that's, to me, that's a priority, to educate and train individuals on how to invest as well. That's why I wrote the book. Of course, everybody is a real estate investor, because, you know, at the end of the day, you're paying rent, you're paying a mortgage, or you're leasing, or you're renting a room at someone's house, because everybody need a place to live. I don't care where you are on this country. You need a place to reside, to rest your head, and either you're renting or you're owning. And to me, whether you're renting, you're still an investor, because, like I said in my book, I touch on topics that explain the difference between an investor that own properties, that's, you know, we call them landlords, because they're lord over that particular land or that particular property. And the tenant is paying them a rent to stay in that particular property. So even though the landlord is he owns it and he's leasing this property to you, he's saying for a fair exchange of, you know, $1,200, $1,300 a month, you can stay on my property. And you know, I need a security deposit, and your monthly rent is whatever, $1,200, $1,300 a month. You're going to rent it for a year, and that's our agreement. Anything that happens to my property, as long as you keep paying rent, you know, you report it to me. You know, you're living here. If something breaks, what I'm doing is I'm taking your rent money, and I'm repairing whatever breaks. If there's a leak, if there's a, you know, stove isn't working or the refrigerator isn't working, whenever you pay rent, I'm managing your money for you, because that's the exchange. So I'm managing that money, and I'm investing it in a new refrigerator or a new stove or a new hot water heater or fixing a roof or patching a hole up on a wall or whatever, because that's a part of the agreement. That I maintain the property as the owner, but the agreement also is that you pay a rent as the tenant. So technically, we're both investing in this property. It's just at the end of the day, if you are the tenant, at the end of the contract, you may leave with your security deposit, depending on the condition that you left the property in. Then there's a chance that you might not, because if I got to replace the carpet, or I got to replace floors, or I got to replace walls and repaint again, it's also in my contract that your security deposit basically protects you from having to do any of the work. I'm doing the work on the property, but that security deposit is there for me to say, okay, I'm giving you this property, but I would like my property back in the same condition that I gave it to you in. And if you don't do the work on the property yourself and go in and fix the property up yourself with your own money when you're leaving, I have to use this security deposit to do that. And so there's a deduction that takes place, and you may not walk away with your security deposit. You may walk back with a portion of it, depending on how much the repairs cost. Now, I did have some cases where, you know, some tenants would leave and the property looked great when they left, so they got their full security deposit back. But that's not always the case with rental properties, unless you just have someone that really, really just, you know, loves taking care of their property, and they'll do the work themselves and give it back to you sometimes in better condition, because they, every little thing they're fixing up, they're touching up, they're making sure that, you know, they keep their house immaculate. And I love those kind of people. But at the same time, now my mindset is changing. Well, why don't I give you a chance at home ownership? Because you've invested in this property for years. So that's where we are now. With our real estate investment strategies, we're teaching people how to become homeowners. And what we'll do is we'll turn some of our tenants, we'll give them the opportunity to own a home. And we call it our affordable housing program. Because, after a while, you want to see people really benefit from investing in properties. As far as rent is concerned, like, I don't want to keep a tenant for 20 years and 30 years anymore. In the beginning, yeah, that was cool. And, you know, I thought about doing it that way. But at this point, it's like, you know, I want to help people become homeowners. So whatever I can do to put you in a position to become a homeowner, that's my goal now. And that has become my priority. So now when I talk to potential tenants, I'm already telling them, like, look, you know, if you're moving into one of our properties here in Trenton, let me turn that down. My bad. I finally got on here to be able to share it as a watch party. Oh, I had some people comment. What's up, Tim? I see you, man. Hey, Miss Arabia, God bless you. Happy birthday. So now our priority is to help people become homeowners, because in Trenton, New Jersey, right now we have somewhere in the neighborhood of 8,000 abandoned properties. And we live in an area that is high in renters and low in homeownerships. I think right now we're at about 30% home ownership in this area, and that's pretty low. That's pretty low. So 70% of the people that live here that is renters, basically. That's what that means. So my goal is, okay, let's help more people become homeowners. How can I do that? Because I know right now the banks don't like lending in this area. Right now, I mean, they will, because we're going through a gentrification process. They will. The value is steady climbing. But why don't we hold the mortgage for individuals opposed to renting to them? Why don't we help them become homeowners, so we can kind of balance those numbers out a little bit? So that has been the goal of our nonprofit organization, One Heaven, Inc., is to educate people on home ownership and to educate, of course, other nonprofit organizations on how to get involved with buying real estate or having properties donated to them. And then training people through our company. It's called, my other business is called Fresh Start Training Academy. And we're teaching people the actual construction trade. So that will equip people on how to do work on properties. So, we're doing some exciting things here that has taken priority in the way that I've done business, or I'm doing business in the future. So as we educate and train individuals, we're hoping to, of course, make more people homeowners opposed to renters. And what we'll do is we'll set up a mortgage note with you. And this is how business was done before banks got involved. Years ago, people would hold mortgages between one another. And if you saw a piece of property you wanted from Mr. Calvin, Mr. Calvin would do an agreement with you. Back in those days, they kind of just wrote something out simple. And going back, you know, maybe 70, 80 years ago, and between the two individuals, you would pay this individual weekly payment or a monthly payment until the house was paid off or until the land was paid off. I can remember my father doing several deals that way, and that's how he kind of taught me in the beginning, like, listen, you know, use cash. Don't go to the banks. Don't use credit. Go to, you know, use cash. If you got $3,000, $4,000, $5,000 to buy the property, buy the property and then fix it up with your own money. And then once the property becomes whatever, you know, the current market value is, you'll be able to sell it and make a great profit. So that was one of the things that we started off doing until I learned, of course, the business credit, which came later on. But by that time, I ended up with, you know, a lot of assets. So in order to liquidate those assets, I had to get involved with learning basically how business credit work. And in learning how business credit work, it kind of catapulted my business strategies and it catapulted it to the next level. So now when I buy properties, a lot of them I do use business credit to buy these properties because I'm doing more flips now in the suburbs. And when we flip in the suburb, we may find a property, say, for $60,000, $70,000. We'll buy the property. We have a company that we use that do 80% of our purchase price. And then they'll do 100% of our construction loan. But it's with the understanding that we're going to take this same property and flip it for a profit. Like I said in the beginning, when I do these type of construction loans, or we call some of them hard money lending, when we do these type of properties, our goal is to only take the loan out for 1 year. So say, for instance, we're buying a property in Ewing. We'll buy it for $60,000, $70,000. We'll put about $50,000 into that property. So we purchased it for $70,000. The company that we use, they'll give us 80% of the $70,000. They'll give us the 80% of the $70,000. So we're only coming up with, you know, somewhere around $10,000 or $15,000 out of pocket. The company that we use will cover the other 80%. Now we'll take that 80%, purchase the property, and then using our business credit, we'll get 100% of the construction loan. So the construction loan, if I do an estimate, it'll be somewhere around $50,000 for this particular property. So now I'm at $70,000, and then I'm at $50,000 for the construction loan. So I'm at $120,000. But that same property will turn around and sell it for maybe $250,000. Right, so we're at $120,000 with purchasing and construction. Then we're selling it for $150,000, which will leave somewhere around $130,000 profit. And we're able to do that several times a year. And it's only because we've learned how to use business credit instead of funding all of our projects out of our pockets. You know what I mean, and it kind of helped increase our purchase power, you know what I mean? Because before, you know, when I was operating, I was buying them for cash, and I was rehabbing them for cash out of pocket, and I was only doing maybe one property at a time. So I would do, back in those days, I was doing maybe three properties a year. About three properties a year. But now I'm doing three properties at one time, three and four properties at one time, like every 4 to 6 months. So I've kind of almost tripled my inventory with real estate investing because I learned how to use business credit and not just rely on cash that I had. You know what I mean? So in using business credit, business credit is given based off of your tax ID number, your EIN number. It's not, there's no personal guarantee. So you're not using your Social Security number. You're using your EIN number. And the business credit is built based off of that platform, opposed to your personal. So we kind of prioritized our business to do more inventory, but at the same time, more education as well. So as we train more and more contractors, as we train more and more real estate investors, it's just going to increase our inventory to be able to help a lot more people. And that's one of our goals. We want to be able to, you know, help other people secure their future and to secure their retirement. So we teach the class every Wednesday at 6 o'clock in Hamilton, New Jersey. So if you're interested in coming, definitely inbox me. I'll let you know the location. And then if we have any openings, I'll update you on that as well. But one of the things you have to do is you have to purchase my real estate book, because I don't want to teach you something that you're not going to apply. In educating you on investing in real estate, it's all about applying what you learn. One of the first classes that we did, I expressed to the guys like this, you know, I know you guys are, you know, subcontractors and contractors and so forth, but what I'm teaching you is going to change your perception about being just a contractor. You're not just, you're more powerful than that. You have more, basically you have more power than the investors that hire you will tell you about, because they can't complete a property without you, without your expertise. So in training these contractors, my goal is always to educate them first, equip them with the right information so that they can make great decisions when they're investing in properties. And I've had, we've been doing the class now for about a month and a half. We've purchased two properties in the last month and a half, and then a couple of the gentlemen that, one in particular, he ended up getting his real estate license. You know, he's practicing real estate full time now. And he came in maybe a week after we started the class, but his hunger and his desire for learning the business was second to none. Like he really jumped in. I educated him on business credit, and he jumped right in on that as well. So I would urge anybody that's looking to invest in real estate, learn as much about it as possible. One of the scriptures that we live by is in Genesis 1:25-28, and it said, God said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let's give them dominion over the fish of the sea and the fowl of the air and over the cattle and over all the earth." So when I hear that, having dominion over all the earth, that's real estate. That's having dominion, that's having government over land. Like he's created you to do that. So not only are you created in God's image, but he's gave you dominion over the land. And I think there has been a disconnect with passing down valuable information to one another, to where some of this stuff got lost in translation. Like we don't understand our true power and what we can truly do, because we don't look at these scriptures and take them as something to apply to our lives. But it says you are made in the image of God and in his likeness. So that means you have creative power. That means you have the power to speak things into existence. You have the power to turn any circumstance in your favor, because you literally have that power. If he's saying he created you in his image, he created you in his likeness, to me, you're limitless, because God is limitless. So if he's limitless, that means if he created you like him, you're limitless. So, you know, we get taught that everything that we want is outside of us, or we have to go outside of us to you know, create happiness, or to create the life, or, you know, we have to chase something that's outside of us. And, you know, we spend our lives chasing something outside of us when God is clearly saying, I've equipped you with everything that you need. I made you in my likeness. So what circumstance do you want to change? You have the power to change it. You don't have to look outside of yourself to change it. All you have to do is use what I gave you. I put a post up this week. You lack nothing. Use the gifts that I've gave you. There's nothing that you lack. There's nothing that you have to go outside of yourself, to, 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 to get in order to obtain happiness. When I teach some men, you know, they talk about, you know, their woman always saying, you know, I want to be happy and this and that. Like, when you met them, did you meet somebody sad? Did you meet somebody that was depressed? Like, is that what attracted you to them? Were they down and out? Were they, you know what I mean? Like, running around with a, you know, a pout look on their face. I know they had to have something that attracted you, and, you know, they laugh and be like, no, she was happy. Okay, so that tells you, if you allow someone to come into your circle and you give them the power to make you happy or unhappy, that's unfair to you. It's unfair to you because you already possess what it takes to make you happy. Now, if you want to share your great self, you want to share your happy self with someone else, that's your prerogative. But you are already complete. You don't need anyone outside of you to make you happy. Like, you're complete already. You're whole already. You didn't come here with someone attached to you. And you're definitely not going to leave here with somebody attached to you either. So, you know, you possess that power. You just have to reprogram the way that you think. Study material that's going to help you put certain things in priority. One is you have to become a priority. Your well-being has to become a priority. Your health, your mental health, your spiritual foundation, your soul has to become a priority. And once you're able to bring that to the level that you see yourself becoming, now you're able to share that greatness with someone else and that love with someone else. And you'll be able to see, you know, exactly what your purpose is. And, you know, some things that you thought you have procrastinated on, you'll really be able to look at it and be like, wow, no, I really wasn't procrastinating. It just wasn't a priority. And I put some things in place that really shouldn't be a priority. I put that in place of things that are and things that should be a priority. And so now you go back and you reorganize it. And you write out your goals and you write out your vision for how you see yourself in the future. You know, right now you may need work. We all do. Ain't nobody perfect. So in writing those things out, you'll put yourself in a position to say, OK, I'm going to prioritize now. And my health is priority. I'm going to take, you know, a day each week or 2 days each week. And I'm going to study what it takes for me to be healthy. You know what I mean? As far as mental health, you do the same thing. Make it a priority to research what will help you become mentally stable. I was having a conversation this morning, and we were talking about prioritizing my you know, your own state of mind, your own state of being. Like, what do you really want to? What do you see for yourself in the next, you know, 2 to 3 years, opposed to the next, you know, couple weeks or couple months or whatever? And, you know, it kind of puts a new perspective on things. It puts a new twist on things. Not only do you begin planning for years to come, you can prepare and plan for your legacy. What do you want to leave behind? What do you want to equip people that's going to inherit a piece of you or a piece of what you leave? How are you going to equip them? And it kind of changes how you deal with people now, and how you deal with your children, and how you deal with your parents. It puts things in a different perspective, because you want to be able to equip them with something that's going to last for a long time, and not just, you know, blow in the wind or be squandered away. And you'll be able to prioritize and you know, your time. That's extremely important. And when we talk about procrastinating, that's what we're speaking of. How do you prioritize your time? Are you, you know, squandering it away and letting things go by that hold value because you're not able to prioritize it properly? I always say people get done what they want to get done. So really, procrastination is just a figment of our imagination, because whatever is important to you at this point in time, you are going to get it done. You're going to complete it. And some things that are, you know, that has less priority, you don't get to it as quick, or you let it linger, and you kind of need a reminder because it's not at the top of your list. So in writing things down, equipping yourself with the right information, it will help you, you know, complete your goals, complete your visions, complete your projects in a timely fashion. Sometimes you'll be able to exceed your own imagination. You'll complete things a lot earlier than you anticipated, and it'll give you time to, you know, go after other goals and write other goals down. So one strategy to use in prioritizing is write it down. Write your vision down. Write your goal down. Don't plan just for 1 month, 2 months. Let's plan for a year. Let's plan for 2 years. Where do you see yourself in 3 years, 5 years? What do you want to accomplish? Because the time is going to go by quick. And you can waste your time, you know, doing a lot of stuff that's not going to benefit you in the long run. But because, you know, it seems important right now, you know, we'll get stuck there. And that's not where you want to be. The years are going to pass. You are going to get older. You do want to leave a legacy. You know what I mean? Especially if you have children. What's up, Kev? I see you, baby. So you want to prioritize by writing these visions down, writing these goals down, and put yourself in a position to where you can exceed your own previously thought limitations, and you'll be able to help others exceed theirs. So write the vision down. We're saying prioritize over procrastination. Procrastination is really just a figment of your imagination. It's something that you haven't had, you know, to put in your top priority, so you'll get to it whenever you got time. So, you know, it's all about manifesting what you want. And the way to do that is write it down. Write it down, organize it. And as you accomplish it each day, you know, your 1 day goal, your 1 week goal, your 1 month goal, your 1 year goal, your 5 year goal, your 10 year goal, you'll be able to check all these things off the list and be able to add more beautiful things to it and accomplish even more. All right. So I thank you guys for tuning in.